You know you're my favorite white boy, right? I owe you for this one.
I've been patiently waiting for a track to explode on. You be stunned if you won't, and your ass will get rolled on. It feels like my flow's been hot for so long. You thinking I'ma fucking fall off, you're so wrong.
I'm menacing in my head, like a baby bone dead. Destination heaven, sitting politic with passengers from 9-11. The Lord's blessings leave me lyrically inclined. Shit, I ain't even got to try to shine. Guards and seamstress, the tailor fitted my pain. I got scriptures in my brain, I can spit at your dame. Straight out the good book, look, niggas is shook. 50 fear no man, warrior, swing swords like Conan.
Hey, what's up? This is 36 Drew, coming to you, OP Productions, ROFL Incorporated. What's up? This is a VOD, courtesy of N3O Clan. You might notice a little something different about this, just based on looking at the user interfaces, various keys that explorers are able to use, and so on. This game is a 2v2 played on vanilla. Imagine that. You notice the treasures look very different, that there is no hotkey for your crack shot. Normally it is the key D by default. And you'll notice that some treasures are rather unguarded. For example, that one is a 25% speed treasure, which I'm just going to kind of be lazy and pick it up with my explorer rather than walk a villager over, and only guarded by a outlaw and a pistolero. So really, they're not guarded by a lot. One of the things you'll notice I'm doing with my crates here, if you ever go back to vanilla to noob it up, this is something you should do if you're Ottoman and you plan on playing Silk Road. Gather your crates until they have 20 resources left. The reason behind this is when you play Silk Road, they will get the 30 resource boost, and you will have, voila, crates that are then worth 50 resources instead of just 20. And when you multiply that by your 5 starting crates, that ends up being 150 resources for free. So that's pretty OP if you ask me. You have to end up chopping an extra 10 wood, but that's just that. I am playing with Donic against Mr. Lazy Tuga. This is a interclan game. This is a really fun game. And Mr. Lazy Tuga, aka Fritz Henrique, aka the dentist, aka the man of the hour, is playing with Soccer Man, who is aka a bunch of other things. Ironically, I've never heard him talk about soccer. Maybe it's called football or something. Or maybe it's, I don't know, lost in translation or something. Regardless, Donic during this game is primarily more interested in his barbecue and his beer drinking. However, that said, it's a very fun game, and I think it will be fun and entertaining to watch. And of course, my hotkeys have not been programmed for vanilla, so when I go to put my explorer back into ranged mode from melee mode, the key A does not work. First card is, of course, 3 villagers. Which is standard for Ottoman in vanilla. However, you have often choices of playing ATP or schooners as your first card. Of course, the change is way back in the days of vanilla. The civs are very different. So, for example, Ottoman Silk Road still gives team 130 crates. Abyss have not had their attack nerfed from 40 to 26. Nor have they had their armor changed or their damage to villagers changed or any of those changes that have occurred in any of the fan patches. However, I mean, the days of 22 range Abyss are long, long, long gone. Long gone. Although I wish I played the game in those days, because that would have been something to see. It's really debatable what the best civ is in vanilla. I think, just by looking at the 1v1 ELO to see who's at the top, that Spain is the best. However, that being said, it really is debatable, and the fact that the majority of the top players do not play vanilla, the majority of them play the War Chiefs, the Asian dynasties, it's hard to really extrapolate from that information. And Lazy Tag will be playing Dutch, and the only thing I notice about his deck is that he's got a lot of mercenaries. Now, the idea here is to do a Silk Road Fast Industrial for me, at which point I will send the unique church card, grab a quick 3 bombards and 15 Janissaries, and then ship some other H4 shipments as necessary. And I would like to send Mercantilism as well to get those shipments coming fast. And this is just fun. This is just pure fun. And of course, the map is Texas. Texas by nature is good for a fast fortress, good for fast industrial. So, you know, it's just going to be one of those scenarios where You're going to have to take advantage of what the map is designed for. And as it were, basically all of us, at the very least FF. Donic is the last player to get there, but he's British, so that's not entirely unsurprising. If that's a word, unsurprising? I don't think that's a word. I'm a teacher, and yeah, that unsurprising, no. It doesn't work. So getting back on track with this game here, you know, just trying to do the math in my head here. Nice thing about your 700 resource crates, with them being increased by 30%, they actually become 910 resource crates, which in H2 is really OP. And then, of course, your 1,000 resource crates become 1,300. So when I ship 1,000 gold in H3 to Egypt Industrial, that's going to provide me with all the gold I need. And my apologies for the black flash between clips. No idea why Fraps has decided to do that to me, but it has. So first card after Silk Road is going to be 700 gold. Next card, I'm going to wait for the next age, which will be 1,000 gold. And basically, I'm just going to gather my food and use Silk Road to end up bringing in food. I know I set it to gold just for a couple crates. And that's about it. A nice thing about Silk Road is that it affects your crates, or affects, you know, the crates that come in. I guess in an original patch a long time ago, let's say, you know, the trade posts had 120 resources, it would actually drop off 120 resources worth of crates at your town center, and you'd actually have to collect them, which is bizarre, because the amount of villager seconds you lose walking over and then gathering them and trying to keep track of them all the time. So the fact that they just automatically end up in your bank account, in your resource stockpiles, is very good. Of course, another thing about vanilla is it's an infantry-based game. Cavalry, you know, from shipments is good. A little bit of cav spamming is good. You know, gendarme are still OP. There has yet to be a patch where they are not OP. You know, you think after 15 patches, you know, combined from ES and the fan patch team and robot entertainment, well, they've never made a patch, but they should. You would be able to fix something like that, but apparently not. So if anyone ever does, kudos to them. And let's think about some other civs. Russia, I believe, still has their quick villager training time. Their villagers train quicker here. Dutch doesn't have their... There was a time when they got 360 XP for building a bank. Here they only get 240, which was a result of one of the patches. However, one of the things about that, about Dutch is, and any expo civ or longbow, is all of the light infantry like that gets a 0.8 bonus times cavalry. And of course, cavalry's range resistance has changed, I believe. So their skirmishers are better against cav, as well as the expos and the longbows and basically all light infantry. I guess even Abyss guns would be included in that. They would not have the 0.8 multiplier like we see in this patch nowadays. So, and some cavalry just melt ridiculously easy, like Uhlans. They just melt, drop like flies. And take a look at the deck. Looks like a pretty standard French deck. Nothing too bizarre. Negatives on this map, I already glanced to see if Apache were there. Because if they were, that was going to be my plan of action, just to take out a lot of villagers using Apache. I recently played a game with Tattletale, former clan member. You can check out the stats on ELO if you want. Just don't look at the rest of my ELO because I've been playing so bad lately. But we basically killed each other's villagers severely in a game. I used Apache and I raided him down to, I believe it was 6 villagers. Meanwhile, he managed to pin me with some veteran Uhlans and he raided me down to 10 villagers. So it was 10 villagers versus 6 villagers. And I had some Highlanders come out, and he ended up having enough skirmishers and war wagons that it was GG. But it was really funny to see somebody win, and he won, and he only had 6 villagers. My plan didn't go 100% according to how I wanted it to, but that'll just kind of happen sometimes. And, you know, I'm just trying to be a little bit random here. By the way, Lazy is in the chat during this time just being absolutely absurd. Just saying the most absurd things right here. I'm complaining that Mother Nature might get my Explorer, and she almost does. However, she does not, so I'm really quite happy about that. Meanwhile, I'm just continuing to manage resources, going up to age 4 with 3 Spahi, The nice thing about going to H4 with the Spahi is they automatically become guard Spahi. And of course, when I went to Fortress Age, I used the Fast Age at Politician. So this Fast Industrial will end up being, you know, just under 10 minutes, or at about 10 minutes, certainly not any longer. The age up time, the Fast Age Politician is 10 seconds quicker in vanilla, because of course it's recently been changed to 40 seconds from 30 seconds. Meanwhile, you know, going to Fortress with regular Politicians has been changed from 120 seconds to 110 seconds. So if, and I may be wrong about those Fortress times, I could be wrong, maybe it was 90 to 100. But if somebody could correct me on that or let me know, that would be great too. Control groups so far right now, I'm just about to add Control 2 for Cavalry, Control 1 was Explore, Control 6 was Town Center. That's how I've always done it. It's how I always will. Of course, I don't really use the Town Center on a whole bunch, simply because you're not training villagers with Ottoman, which is why many people say they are a noob civ, and if just for nothing other than the ease of play, I would agree that they are kind of a noob civ, because it's really easy to be successful with them at lower levels, but at higher levels, it's really difficult to be successful with. In the current state of affairs, they're a weaker civ. However, I felt if some people gave them the attention they deserve, they would be reasonable. And I run into some halberdiers. Of all the places, there's about 900 square meters on this map to run around. I would choose to run directly into some veteran halberdiers. Not good, not good, not good. But that's okay. Meanwhile, my partner, I have asked him to spam muskets, and that is the idea, to keep doing that. I say OMW on my way. I see just a little bit of skirmishers there, and I would like to kill them. And ooh, I see a little bit of dragoons. However, I'm about to church Big Tech 3 Great Bombards, and I'm going to set the rally point to my tower just to get them, you know, a couple meters closer to the battlefield so that they can get there as soon as is possible. Meanwhile, I'm going to switch my gatherers to gold because I'd like to gather enough gold to have mercantilism researched, because when you have a whole bunch of ridiculous H4 shipments, you gotta do it, especially when you're there so soon when you need very little experience to gather a shipment. And you know what? Even with 20 card decks in here where you don't get as many useful shipments, you still definitely get enough for it to be worthwhile here. I'm going to set my cannons to control 3, by the way. And when my big button Janissaries pop out, which will be, I can't remember, in a minute or two, they'll be set to control 1. So it goes infantry, cavalry, artillery. And basically that's how they will stay throughout this game. And you know, I haven't given a whole lot of thought to hotkeys for Ottoman. So that, you know, that's just whatever. It is what it is. And he runs away, but no, 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 no. You cannot run from the bombards. They will get you sooner or later. And there goes the mercantilism research. And that's going to give me 3 shipments in queue, 2 of which I will just send both factories right away. And the third one, I believe I end up sending Team 1000 coin, which is actually Team 1300 coin. So that's like a 2600 coin shipment, because we each get 1300. So that's a pretty ridiculous age for shipment in its own, especially because Texas is like resource barren. There's not a lot on the map really is going to be useful for you know, both of us here. And you know, 5 dragoons don't really stand a chance at slowing down 3 bombards. Even in melee mode, they're not going to do it. Plus I have 15 Janissaries and the Spahi there, not going to do it. Meanwhile, I'm getting raided back my base from these veteran couriers. Not gendarme just yet, however they will be soon enough, soon enough, soon enough. And there a factory pops out. You notice I changed the rally point so that he's not going to see it pop out at my town center. I change it so that it pops out of my tower rather than my town center, and I set the rally pointed in the east direction. You know, some of these things, this game is a horse around game, but still, these things can be maybe useful tips, I'm not sure, hard to say. And there I see yellow Mr. Lazy Tuga. I'll go to send in my Spahi. Oh, except he's got Mr. Swiss Pikeman there. I have Mr. Bombard. Booyah. Look at that. 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12, 12. Try saying that 12 times over. It's like try saying toy boat you know, 10 or 12 times in a row. And if you can do it, get back to me on it and we'll work out on arranging a contract for some form of linguistics. That's toy boat. Try saying it a whole bunch of times. If you can do it, you're an amazing man. Meanwhile, I just got my town center up. You know, this strategy is not based around economy at all. It's based strictly around massing military, whereas the French and the Dutch are based, you know, quite primarily around economy, as well as British. So, you know, every other player in the game's got an economic-based approach, while I do not. And I'm having both my factories. I do set them to control 9, just so I have an easy way to set their rally point. I've done that ever since the beginning of time, and I probably always will. There's a lot of ways that old men get stubborn like that when it comes to gameplay. And actually, this push into Donic space is going to end up causing some grief. You know, we're going to take out some houses, which normally isn't too detrimental. Spahi's still, you know, with their guard statistics, do a number on streetlets here. Going to ship an additional 2 bombards to come join the fight. Hesitant to get in there with my Janissaries, simply because of the heavy infantry bonus that the skirmishers have. And now, of course, boom, don't you know, 12 plus, 12 plus, 12 plus, etc., etc. That's just a beautiful sight. I just love it. To my surprise, this game I would have thought would have been much, much more one-sided. I thought at this point, you know, I just got masses of artillery floating around here. And in fact, Lazy's gone to the fourth age. So, meanwhile, Donic has also gone to the fourth age as well. I would have thought this game would have been, you know, at this point, we're just going to roll over them. I've got like 8 bombards, you know, 15 Janissaries, a couple Spahi, and Donic's got a bunch of muskets. So let's just push in and what happens, happens. However, it ain't so. They make a pretty good game out of this, and they have a huge mass. And at one point, my entire fleet ends up being jeopardized. And here, even though Swiss pikes get the cannons at the melee, it just, oh boy. I mean, those units just go flying. He's able to take out one of the bombards, but, you know, thankfully I just reacted just in time to get them out of their limber mode and into their attack mode. So, yeah, I'm going to pop them back into their ranged mode. And in retrospect, right about now, since they've gone age 4, they're Dutch, going to spam cannons right back in my face. I should be making culverins right now. I'm kind of at a loss of what to do strategy-wise here. I'm thinking about just getting a second and third town center up, and I kind of want to send it on the other side of the map there. Just have a little bit of control, a little bit of a spot to fall back to. So I'm going to send my explorer in that direction. Meanwhile, I flag the area I'd like to attack, which is kind of in between their bases. There's a tower there, and I think there's a bunch of villagers sitting behind it. From the church, I go to research the unit line of sight tech. I just really like that tech when using artillery, and I usually always research the artillery line of sight tech from the church, because when you have an extra 8 line of sight, especially when you're using things like culverins or cannons, you can often get the first hit off instead of your opponent, and getting the first hit off instead of the second is gonna, you know, make a big difference, especially when things like culverins you're involving. You know, if 2 culves hit the Falk, you know, you're gonna one hit kill them. And, you know, 2 culverin royales with the upgrade will one hit kill a heavy cannon or great bombard, and that's significant. Meanwhile, Soccer Man's gone H4. And I'm going to take my Janissaries. I'm trying to pop them into melee mode, but I forget that I'm in vanilla and that you need to actually click the button to put them in melee mode. So I'm going to do that. Meanwhile, send 5 Mamelukes. Of course, it's 5 Mamelukes instead of 4. And once I get them into melee mode and have my Spahi sitting there, they make short change of those Cuirassiers, and we will continue our push. Meanwhile, I noticed my explorer has died walking over there, so I'm going to decide to build a town center in a more safe location, and in fact I'm going to build a second one. And here I'm going to press the G key, because G is the hotkey for town center. Not working. It's this bloody vanilla business. Things like that happen. You live with it, you learn, that's life. So I'm going to walk forward here, again resetting my rally point from where my shipments are going to come in, hoping that those 5 Mamelukes will get here. I'm not sure. Mameluke shipment time was changed from 30 seconds, along with all mercenaries, to 60 seconds in a certain patch. I'm not exactly sure which one, if it would be changed for this one or not. My gut reaction on just how long it took in the game for them to come in, and I mean, I guess someone could click and drag back on the video and figure out just how long it took. But I want to say that it took 60 seconds rather than 30 seconds, because 30 seconds is pretty quick, you know, just like a standard 5 villager shipment. It will be there. And this bombard is all alone, and there come masses of culverins, which I should have anticipated, but I didn't really. This is an interesting trade-off. I take my 5 Mamelukes, and I just decide that I'm going to kill every single one of those culverins and kind of sacrifice them. They'll have no problem killing them with 1450 HP. As soon as it's killed, I'm going to retask them so they don't run back into the Reuters. I'm going to do some other things because they'll take a few hits to kill them. I'm going to go back, try and find them, retask them on the culverins, and so on and so on. Was that cost effective? Hard to say. 5 culverins, you know, is going to cost 2,000 coin and 500 wood. Meanwhile, the Mamelukes is equivalent to 1,000 coin plus 1,000 coin for the shipments. So, you know, it's equivalent to 2,000 resources is what the Mamelukes are. They cost 400 gold each from a saloon. But, you know, there's also the matter of, you know, could you have used those units better? So, but however, those culverins, since I'm going so heavy on bombards, they do have to die. And really at this point, I'm kind of like, I have lost the majority of my army, which is interesting. But I'm getting 3 town centers up and all the church techs. Of course, the church techs cost food in here to get villagers to train faster. The ones to get more villagers cost wooden coin. But there's none of this villagers arriving with the church, which I actually think is a real nice idea for a change for the Ottomans. Gives them some more versatility with strategy. I just think that their age 2 units were nerfed a little too much. It was nice to get Janissaries with a boosted attack for cavalry. That's definitely helped. Abbas could use maybe a bit more on their attack. The problem with Ottoman right now in this state of affairs is you basically need a 3-unit combo to win, which is Abbas, Janissary, Hussars. Sometimes you can win with 2, but usually you need 3. And so you need to make every single military building. You need a stables, you need a foundation, you need a barracks. Whereas a civ like China, they just have to make one building. And also, when you're looking at Ottoman player, if you walk in and you scout early racks, you know exactly what he's doing. He's making early Janissaries. Nothing else he could make from a barracks. Same thing with the foundation. You can only make Abbas guns. Unless he would do something stupid like make grenadiers, but it's generally not a very good idea, so please don't do that. Unless you're just horsing around. In which case, by all means, do all those things. So, I've got the bombards spawning, you know, into an in-base location, and they're kind of getting spread out because sometimes you lose track of them, but they spawn slow enough that you should be able to keep track of them. And 11 Janissaries comes from another H4 shipment here. Meanwhile, Donik is just continuing to mass muskets, and in fact, they are Redcoat Musketeers. I never could understand why they were called Redcoats. If someone could explain the historical significance, that would be interesting, as well as maybe why Portugals are called Guerrero Musketeers. I'm sure that there's some piece of information there. Actually, if you'll notice that I got my explorer to use his, not Eagle Eye Shot, whatever the age for one hit kill features there. He was about to die. Might as well take a skirmisher out with him. There's a hotkey for it, which is Q, which I use all the time if I'm playing in the Asian Dynasties, but of course doesn't exist for this. There's a couple things that don't exist. I always use Alt to show hit points for units. So for example, let's say I'm raiding. I want to kill the villager that just has like one tick of health left, so I press Alt, and then I'll raid that villager first because, you know, he'll die right away regardless, even if your opponent's reaction time is perfect. And same thing when raiding with ranged units. You want to be shooting the one that's about to die first, you know, unless you've got really good multi-volley or something and you can, you know, shoot that one as well as another one. So, and of course that, you know, if you do, by all means, it's more power to you to do that. And you'll notice, there's a big mass of Reuters, skirmishers, hackapels, cannons, basically a big mass of everything in our base. This is one of those, it's almost like Great Lakes. You know, you have to run around the whole map and circle. Meanwhile, I've got these bombards there that would be nice to use, but they have no cover whatsoever. So, they've got to wait and get thrown into my control group. And I do have a foundation at this point up, and it is training culverins, or there they are, the first two culverins that I trained. And they're not going to do so well in this battle. Lazy's going to have much more artillery, and I'm not going to do such a great job at microing here against his cannons, which is, you know, just really too bad. Would have been nice to do that. And I noticed I missed a church check there on line of sight, the building line of sight. I just love line of sight. One of the things you may or may not know is that it automatically increases every time you age up. So you hit fortress. Yeah, you get a fortress politician. You also get buildings that have greater line of sight. That includes things like docks as well. So here I'm going to set these to attack, and I'm going to manually split them into two groups. He gets the first shot off, which, you know, it's just huge. And there I select my culverins, and got Janissaries coming to the forefront. Here comes Donic. Now, I kind of make a mistake there of letting... I should keep my bombards focused on there. You know, those Reuters aren't going to do a whole lot. They will kill great bombards, but by the time they kill them, it's going to be a while. So, and as you can see, my army of artillery has it's suffered quite a bit. It's not doing so well there. And one of my trade posts has fallen. And of course, Stagecoach and Silk Road means that a trade post is equal to close to 3 villagers. And once you get the Iron Horse upgrade, which I have here, in fact, it's worth a little over 4 villagers. So those are, you know, quite beneficial. You put those together and it's almost as much as a factory would produce. Factory is equivalent to 10 villagers. So, and then, of course, if you get the 30% upgrade, it's equivalent to closer to 10 villagers. So, and getting those upgrades is basically automatic, basically mandatory. And he's going to be smart with these skirmishers. He's going to run away. So I'm just going to, look at that dragoon fly at close range. Imagine a man on a horse getting hit by a bombard at close range. That would hurt. That would hurt a lot. And well, I've got 3 town centers spawning villagers here. And since this is such a heavy, heavy military-based approach, you know, you can expect that you're probably going to be one of the players who gathers less resources. And by the way, this strategy, you can still very much do this on the Asian dynasties. You might not want to go Silk Road. You just want to play Stagecoach. And on a map like this, where it's kind of designed to FF, you know, you can go for it. And depending on the civilization you're playing, the Ottoman FF, especially with a little bit of an economy like using Stagecoach or the villager shipments from the church, is still viable, and you can do it nakedly. Like if you're going to play someone who's going to FF or semi-FF, which you could do also with Ottoman, you could, you know, go for I like the 8 Hussar semi-FF. You make 5 and you ship 3, and then you split them into 2 groups of 4, and you just run around raiding, trying to keep your opponent off resources. Buy time, get a couple trade posts, ship a couple villagers from your church, and hit fortress. And you know, their fortress shipments are still good. 2 Falks, 5 Spahi, 3 Spahi, 4 Mamelukes, all very, very good. So here we're trying to collect our forces again, and we're hitting Sacrament pretty hard, or were, I should say. Donic is hitting Sacrament pretty hard, causing him some grief. And I'm just going to keep spamming Janissaries as my unit to back up my artillery, along with some culverins for anti-artillery. The Janissaries, of course, are a veteran at this point. I don't recall, but I don't believe I get them to the guard status, which would be nice. And I want to take down that factory, because, of course, factories being irreplaceable, much better than taking down, let's say, villagers, plantations, all those things. But then you notice, there's a big, big, big mass of heavy cannons in our base. And, you know, kind of wondering where Lazy's factories are. Haven't walked around his base hardly any. But it would be nice to know where they are, because if I knew they were very close to me right now, I probably would try to somehow muster out enough Janissaries and culverins and heavy cannons to just hold them, you know, with those and Minutemen and my Explorer and all that, while I walk into his base and get his factories. But I really don't have a clue where they are. So I've got to go all the way back, and it's going to take a while, because heavy cannons don't move fast at all. And it's just, it's a heck of a mass. This is kind of one of those fun games where the basses get rearranged, at least, you know, a little bit. I know several of you were involved in a clan game recently. It was on, I'm trying to think of the name of the map, I'm sure it was on Andy's. It was a 3v3. Every single player lost their starting town center before the 15-minute mark of the game. And really, everyone did a complete 180 around the map, more so than I've seen in every other game before. And here comes Mr. Bombard with some Janissaries to support that I'm going to continue to try to spam. Barracks get thrown in control 5. By the way, it's nice to start with a free barracks on this map. And Lazy sees the great bombards that are coming in here, and he decides to take a run for it. And probably with good reason, because I do have some other support sitting around here too. And, you know, things get kind of messy when there's a whole bunch of villagers involved here. I do not like when a whole bunch of villagers become involved. I have a habit of dragging them into battle. I do not use easy drag military as a feature. I do not like it. I've tried using it before. And there I'm trying to micro my culverins directly onto his artillery. And you can see, boom, boom, get two of the falconets just like that. Re-micro them to a heavy cannon. By default, let's say you set your culverins to attack a heavy cannon, they will just attack whatever next. They won't necessarily continue attacking heavy cannons if there's more and they're in range. That's just the nature of the unit. And right here, I'm going to just lame it up. Just lame it up. You'll see what I'm talking about in a second and you guys will laugh. And Soccerman says GG. To which, you know, at this point, it probably is. The scores are starting to go kind of heavily in our favor. And I love that 12+, 12+, 12+, 12+. Lazy still has a decent army of skirmishers here, which getting obliterated by the bombards, as they are called. You can see the lovely stagecoach wagon going by there. And, pause, micro, anybody? This never gets old. I tell you, I could do this all day with great bombards and sit here just individually microing them onto infantry and just watching them fly. And of course, you give a nice taunt 11, are you ready? And that's just awesome. I just love it. Oh, so good. And, you know, it was a really fun game. The Ottoman Fast Industrial has got, you know, it's just a classic. It is just so fun. Thanks for watching, guys. I hope you enjoyed the game. I'll just take a quick look at the graphs after the game. You'll notice, like I had mentioned before, that, you know, it's not really an economy-based approach. Ottoman hardly ever is, with the exception of a sea boom, maybe some other weird strategies. But, and you know, there's all of Lazy's banks. Of course, he's Dutch. And, there's his factories. It's a good thing I decided not to push further into his base, because I would have not found any factories. Would have been able to hurt him probably pretty severely, but he would have hurt me, you know, very severely also. You notice I gathered second least resources, and my military population never really gets that high, but it doesn't really need to. Good game, Donick, Lazy, and Soccerman. Thanks for watching, guys. Hope you enjoyed it. Take care.